ashes of defeat, the resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I will come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrected.
We sing hallelujah. Good morning, everyone. Happy Easter, and I trust that you and your family, knowing that we're under lockdown, that we still celebrating our Easter together. So once more, as you will see, that Karen will join us later, just for communion, the breaking of bread, and also the wine symbolic of his blood. And so for us, Easter around the world is so much different. And as you know, that the church building is empty, and so is the grave, and so is the tomb. And this is very much symbolic as you are missing coming together as believers. I don't think right across the world, it's empty spaces, it's an empty tomb, symbolic of an empty tomb, yes. And just realize that he is the resurrection and the life. And so the word of God teaches us in Ecclesiastes that there's a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven. And so he talks about the time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot. And so we're in a different season. But know this, in every season, that God is with us. If it's winter, summer, spring, or autumn, just know this, that he is with us. He's called this name Emmanuel. God is with us. So for us, yes, we would like this to go away so quickly. But I do believe that we need to find God in every season. And that's why Jesus said, he also want this cup to pass him by and say, Lord, nevertheless, your will to be done, your kingdom to come in my life. And so as we find ourselves in this season, the word of God does say that he makes everything beautiful in his time. And so won't you find God's resurrection power? Won't you find life in this season? And no matter how difficult it is, I know there's fear, there's anxiety, there's uncertainty around the world. But he is and he will remain our good shepherd. And he will lead us through the valleys and the valley of the shadow of death, the valley of coronavirus, that he will lead us beside quiet waters. So I just want to share with you just briefly on the Father's love to you. And you have heard me somehow in the pulpit since last year. And and also this year, just talking about the Father's love. And so I'm going to bring two points across. The Father's love, but also Jesus' sacrifice towards us. So these are the two points that I want to share with you, the God's love and Jesus' sacrifice. And so, as you know, that somehow, as we look at the scripture, and also the theme for this year was really clarity and sharpness from the Father. Somehow around the world, that structures and systems, they are failing us now. And the word that God gave me this year is just our Father. And there's no more tricks in the bag the way we used to do church. And so it's really just coming with humble hearts to the Creator of the universe and say, God help us. God be merciful. And so the scripture that I want to read to you is 1 John 1, 9 and 10. This is how God showed his love amongst us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might have life through him. Verses 10 say, this is the love, that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice for our sin. He basically is, this is the love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice for our sin. And here you find that this love of God is also found in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And so this scripture is so powerful because many of us, myself included, this is the love, not that we love God. And for many a times I, in my own strength and my own ability, I want to love God from this perspective. But the Word of God say, it's not when how you loved me, it's what you need to understand is how much I loved you and the sacrifice that I've made for you. And so when I came to realize that, I saw that my view of loving God was a bit blurred. And I saw God's love through a filter of my upbringing, through a different lens. The image that I have of God was very much based on of how my earthly father was. And so in the hurt, the pain and the trauma, I tried to serve God in my understanding about his love. And there was a lot of works, a lot of sacrifices. I thought I can earn God's love through the more I fast and pray, and there's nothing wrong. These are Christian disciplines, and I'm still doing it, and I still love it. But my perspective now, it's not so much the sacrifices and the works that I'm doing to earn God's love, but it's really the way he loves me. And this is an amazing revelation, is that we can continually just trust God. And so, Lord, my love towards you probably will fail. But if I look your love towards me, it will remain. And so, basically, I just want to talk about a father that embraces two sons. And you know the story of the prodigal son in Luke 15. And this father have these two sons, the younger and the older one. And the older one and the younger one have a perception of the love of God from one side, which all of us are pursuing from a one side, how we can love God. But from this prodigal son, if we can look it from the father side. And so if I look at this, and you know there was a younger son representing just the rebellion, the rebelliousness, and our hearts that was once far away from God, and we were doing our own thing. But the older son speaks about people who are probably Christians, and they find themselves in the house, and they find themselves worshiping God and praising God and doing all the disciplines that comes with it. But also there is something that they didn't understand, the heart of the father. So for me, if I look at the younger son, he'd basically say, give me all my inheritance. He went and with wine, woman and song, and he was just, listen here, dad, I want all my stuff and I'm going to enjoy myself. And yes, a famine broke out. And what happened, like what is happening now, and he realizes and he comes to his realization that, listen here, man, I'm doing my own thing. I'm away from my father, but I need to come back to that love. I need to realize that there is somebody that loves me. And the Word of God, see, he came to his senses. And I must say, honestly, there is such an awakening of the youngest son across the world. No evangelist, no pastor, no prophet can do such a stirring like what is happening across the world. And God is using this whole situation for his good. And no church group can take credit the way people are calling out to God towards his love. And I know that the shelves were empty when we heard that there is lockdown. But you know that the Bibles also went. Do you know that some people are singing songs and are online, and there is just a hunger and thirst after God? People are crying out in the street and praying in the street. And so this is amazing. There is an awakening of who God is. And so we are not to judge the younger son and what is happening in the world. Many of people say this is God's judgment. I don't believe so. Many of people say this is God's wrath and God is angry. I don't see it according to Scripture. When the younger son came to his father, he thought that the father is going to judge him. The father is going to ridicule him and chase him away. But the father stood with his arms wide open and ran to him. He kissed him and embraced him. And he put shoes on him and he put a ring and a robe. And there was a celebration. So for us as Christians, no matter what has happened around the world, there is an awakening, like I say, and there is an awareness of God, that many a people will come to know this God. And I do believe from the Father's heart, He will say to you, He was lost, but now He's been found. He was dead, but He's alive now. And God is going to do that to many of you who is listening to this. And the older son, which was in the house, and he heard the celebration, but was quite angry and upset. And he's basically the one that have worked so hard. He was loyal. He was obedient. And he was quite upset. And he basically say, why must this celebration be for the son? For the younger son that have squandered your inheritance. And so for me, I look at this and the father said, listen here, my younger son have received my love. He was lost, but now he's been found. But for us that are Christian, this represent a religious person or somebody that is in the house. And he say to you, you always have been with me and everything that I have is yours. Somehow this older son was missing the point that the father, he was always with the father. He could have enjoyed his presence. And he said, everything that I got. Maybe the older son was worried that he must now share his inheritance with this younger one. Basically, the father affirmed him that everything that I got is yours, my son. And you've always been with me. We don't know the response of the older son and say, listen, yeah, I'm going to celebrate. But the point is the love of the father for the rebellious son or the son that is in the house doesn't change. No amount of work, no amount of sin, no amount of obeying and sacrifices will change the perspective from God's side towards us. While we were yet sinners, rebellious or religious, that He loves us. And so in close, I just want to read Revelation 3:20. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and open the door, I will come in and eat with him. And you know that this scripture was very much geared up towards Christian. And we use it for those people who must come to the Lord. But this was one of the seven churches who they were believers. And he said, listen here, you can be, you're neither hot or you're cold. You are in between. You are lukewarm. And if you're lukewarm, I spit you out. Be hot or cold, man, but don't be in between. And so for us, this is also awakening and awareness for us as Christians. How's our relationship with God? Is it duty? Is it work? Is it mechanical? Is it really a deep relationship of God? Understanding that no matter what goes on around the world, and no matter what the uncertainty, that we got a Father that we can put our trust and our hope in. And so no matter how difficult it is, can we rest? And yes, there's anxiety and there's fear. But can we rest knowing that God is still in control? He is the Ancient of Days. And so this knocking, I know that you can't invite anyone, neither your friends and your family, over. But there's a knock at your door. For those who do not know the Lord as a Savior, symbolic of the younger son. And for those, there's a knocking at your door. Your relationship and your heart have gone cold towards the Father. There's also awakening for you. You've been in church. You've been doing all this stuff. But there's an emptiness and there's a void. And God is knocking at your door. If you hear my voice, let me come in. Jesus say, and that's why we go to the second point, that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. If you want to experience this love of the Father, Jesus say, I'm the door, I'm the way, I'm the truth, and I'm the life. If you hear my voice today, and that's why this 21 lockdown was like a Sabbath. Sabbath is symbolic that 6 days you work, the 7 days you rest. The world doesn't go around you. You are not the Savior. You are not the rescuer. But the Sabbath is to rest in God. And for us, the whole world came to a stop almost. And rest. And just be still. And know that He is God. And so in this time, as your soul has been quiet, and your mind and your body, can you hear the voice of the Father knocking at your door? And won't you open the door so that He can commune with you? And lastly, I just want to pray for you. For those who are like far away from God, I want you to say this prayer. Father God, I come to you in Jesus' name. I realize that I'm a sinner in need of your Savior. Forgive me of all my sin and wash me in your precious blood. Today I'm a child of you and heaven is my home. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to pray for you that somehow and we're going to partake in communion right now. Karen will join us. Let this be the sacrifice of His blood and His body broken for you, so that we can experience the love and the grace and the mercies of our God. Don't stand at the outside. The Father is calling you once more to have a meal with you, Father, Mother, and even children. And probably the mechanical and the religious way and the way we perceive how we need to act as Christians. And somehow God just wants to give you a new revelation and a fresh revelation about the love of God towards you. So Father God, I pray that you will open each one of our eyes. Yes, we maybe have worked hard, we are loyal, and all our doings. But let us find delight in your presence. Find delight in Jesus Christ. Father, I pray, O God, that there will be a true and authentic relationship with you. And we repent of lukewarmness. I pray, O God, from today that we will worship you in spirit and in truth. Holy Spirit, come and empower us. Reveal to us what Christ has done on the cross so that we can have this true and authentic relationship with our Father. In Jesus' name. And as I will ask Karen just to join us with communion, please go and fetch something to drink and something to eat. Gather your family around the table as we will serve the communion. May God bless you.
Hi, everyone. Just want to greet you all in that wonderful and precious name of Jesus, and also just take the opportunity to wish you a very happy Easter. Mm-hmm. May you just enjoy this time with your family. It's a time to really celebrate that Jesus is no longer on the cross and He's resurrected and He's alive forevermore. Amen. This morning we're going to partake of the communion, and so we're going to do that together. So as you gather your family, it will be great. And then once we've broken and shed of the blood, speak of His communion, we can share together as a family. So Jesus' body was broken for us, and the bread represents his body that was broken, that we can receive healing. And we think especially now in the time of the coronavirus, for the sickness, that we can trust God together for healing for those that have been affected, and we, for our family even, if they are suffering, for us in our own bodies, and we can trust God that as his body was broken for us, that the Bible says that by the stripes of Jesus we can receive our healing. So we're going to partake of the body of Christ as the bread and just trust God for that. And then we're going to partake of the cup, which resembles the blood of Jesus when he died on the cross and he shed his blood for our sins. And so we can come, sometimes we sin in our thoughts. We think, why, Lord, did you have to, why is this happening? Why are people dying? And so we need to just confess our sins before the Lord, and God knows best. God is sovereign. And so his body, his blood was shed for our sins. And so we're going to take a time and confess our sins and trust God that his blood would cover a multitude of sin. And so before we partake, we're going to say the Our Father together. Can we do that? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Just gather your family and maybe partake of the emblems of the communion this morning as a family.
God bless.
God bless.